Hello, this is Keith Jansky. I am a Century College student pursuing an AAS degree in ITT. I am doing a video tutorial project on the Raspberry Pi. What is a Raspberry Pi? This is a Raspberry Pi. If you're not familiar with this device, it is basically a mini open source computer. It was founded by the Raspberry Pi Foundation to make a smaller, more affordable computer. It can do many of the things a laptop and a desktop PC can do, like spreadsheets, word processing, and games, and this small circuit board design. It has limitations though. They are much smaller than your ordinary PC, so it doesn't have the space and cooling capacity of a laptop and a desktop PC, which limits its processing and RAM potential. The current Model B version 2.0 only has 512 MB of RAM, so you cannot use graphics intensive applications on it. It can handle a Linux GUI pretty well though, and can play movies including HD movies at ease due to its architecture of sending data. You can play some games, but graphics intense gaming such as first person shooters will probably not work on these current models. The device has several ports and connectors. It has an HDMI port, a composite video port, an RJ45 port, two USB ports, and an audio jack. The device also has a few internal connectors: the GPIO connector, the CSI connector, and the DSI connector. The GPIO stands for General Purpose Input Output. It is a 24-pin connector that can be used for additional features, such as input switches for on and off buttons, reset buttons, and output device LEDs. It works the same as the GPIO connector on your desktop PC motherboard. The CSI is a ribbon connector made for a camera, and the DSI is also a ribbon connector made for a display. These can be used in addition to the video and USB ports for optional peripherals. These connectors are not necessary for the functioning of the Raspberry Pi though. Only a keyboard, mouse, and monitor are required for using the device, just like a regular desktop PC. For more information on additional uses for internal connectors, you can go to YouTube user Raspberry Pi for Beginners and at the Raspberry Pi Wiki, elinux.org/RPI_hardware. There are three primary uses for this device. First, it can be used as a multimedia device. You can install movies, videos, low graphic processing, games, music, and play them and browse the web just like regular laptop or desktop computers. Second, it can be used as a networking device. You can use it to access the network's internal operating systems, terminals, and command prompts. Third, it can be used as a personal computer with limitations compared to a laptop or desktop PC. It doesn't have the same expandability of a desktop PC, such as the ability to add hardware and software. It has more storage limitations than a desktop PC, and again less graphics processing capability. But for price versus performance and return on investment, the Raspberry Pi far outweighs the costs of current laptop and desktop computers. Where to buy? Until recently, people were prohibited from buying more than one of these devices, but that restriction has now been lifted. Now you can buy as many as you want. I think it has something to do with supply and demand. The makers couldn't keep up. The Raspberry Pi's distributors are Newark.com, aka Element 14, Allied Electronics for in the US, and ROS Components for outside the US. Newark.com and Allied Electronics seem to sell them the cheapest at $35. But they seem to often be out of stock. Amazon.com seems to always be in stock, but sells them at a higher price. I found mine on eBay for a moderate price, but make sure to get the Model B version 2.0 as of now, because it has twice as much RAM as Model A's, and some Model B's version 1.0. 512 MB of RAM is already inadequate for the GUI of the Debian operating system. Cases. Currently, these devices don't come with cases. Due to cost, the developers of Raspberry Pi chose not to make them, but have plans to eventually come out with some. There are many people who still make them though, and you can buy them online. You can make nice cases for these yourself, if you have access to machines like a laser engraver or a 3D powered base rapid prototyping machine, also known as the 3D printer. We have them here at Century College in our fab lab. The laser engraver can cut out any two-dimensional image and make engravings of anything you can think of. Create on a computer with CorelDRAW. We use CorelDRAW to create drawings and to give the coordinates to the laser engraver, which is basically a cutting and engraving machine using a laser. It can cut through or engrave cardboard, acrylic, and other thin materials precisely. You can make a 3D version of a case made out of ceramic material with a 3D printer. The way a 3D printer works is it lays down microscopic layers of an adhesive material and slowly builds upon it layer by layer until it is complete. It can make almost any 3D shape imaginable, but it takes much longer than the laser cutting machines. These pieces of machinery are very expensive, and CorelDRAW is hard to work with if you don't have experience with it. We tried using an existing template found online that did not quite fit the dimensions of the Raspberry Pi. After adjusting the dimensions for a long time, we were still not able to get it to fit perfectly. Unless you have access to these machines and are experienced with CorelDRAW, or you have $20,000 lying around to buy this equipment and learn it yourself, I recommend just buying a case online. I like the laser cut acrylic cases sold by this particular eBay seller, Luck Lue. The case snaps together with no fasteners. It has perfectly aligned openings for the ports and has a unique flip-top lip for access to the internal connectors. His cases fit perfectly and don't cost much. He has them in different colors, red, yellow, blue, green, and clear. He has his own CAD file of the case dimensions, but was unwilling to share the file with me, so the only way to get this case for now is to buy it from him. I am attempting to reverse engineer it on CorelDRAW. To assemble this case with the Raspberry Pi inside is a little cumbersome, but it doesn't take long to figure out. Notice this Raspberry Pi case has six pieces. One bottom piece, two shorter side pieces, which I call end pieces, one back end piece, and one front end piece. The front end piece is the one with the USB and Ethernet port openings. The back end piece is the one with the SD card and micro USB port openings. Two longer side pieces, one with the composite video and audio port openings, and one with the HDMI port opening. One top piece, which I call the flip top cover, has three openings for the internal connectors. The openings are not removed though, you can leave them intact if you don't plan on using them. These pieces have brackets and voids to make the case fit together with no fasteners needed. This video from Adafruit Industries shows a tutorial on assembling a very similar case. The longer side pieces have these little cutouts on the bottom called dragon claws. These make the hooks slightly flexible, allowing the end plates to snap the entire case together snug with no fasteners, while also making disassembly easy. My case has the same dragon claws, but be careful with them, they can break easily. First, put the Raspberry Pi on the bottom piece as shown. As you can see, the bottom piece has four brackets. These are used to hold the longer side pieces in place. Second, put the longer side pieces in, making sure they align with the bottom piece brackets and Raspberry Pi ports as shown. With a clear case, all the port label engraving should be on the inside. With the colored cases, some are on the outside. Make sure the holes for the flip-top cover brackets line up as shown. Third, align the two flip-top cover piece brackets with the holes on the longer side pieces as shown. Make sure that it is put on the correct side, or the internal connectors will not line up with the openings as shown. Fourth, put the back end piece on with the SD card and micro USB port openings until it snaps into place with the side piece hooks as shown. Place the top end piece holes into the top side piece hooks at an angle and push into place the bottom end piece holes into the bottom side piece hooks with the dragon claws. Fifth, put the front end piece on the USB and Ethernet port openings until it snaps into place with the side piece dragon claw's hooks, as shown. Be careful not to break the bottom side piece hooks with the dragon claws when inserting and removing these two end pieces, as they can be fragile. USB power adapter. The Raspberry Pi gets power from the micro USB port. In order to do that, you need to get a micro USB power supply with a cable. Any micro USB cable should work with it, but to be on the safe side, I recommend buying a USB power supply that comes with a cable so you don't have to worry about that. These are easy to find and relatively inexpensive. The site suggests getting a good quality micro USB power cable, capable of providing at least 700 milliamps at 5 volts. Do not attempt to power your Raspberry Pi by plugging into a computer or hub. Based on reviews I have seen on YouTube and forums, I suggest getting one with a minimum electrical output capacity of 5 volts at 1 amp or greater, to ensure your device receives an adequate flow of electricity all the time regardless of activity. Operating systems. There are numerous operating systems that can be installed on this device. A version of Windows 8 can be installed on this called Windows 8 RT, but it's not recommended due to the size of and RAM utilization. You will need an SD card with a capacity of at least 16 GB with Windows 8 RT alone, as it is 8 gigabits in size, and it uses too much RAM. A version of Linux called Debian is a beginner's operating system used for this device and the one recommended on their website, raspberrypi.org. I will be talking about how to install the operating systems Debian and OpenELEC, the Media Center version specific to videos, which is also very easy to use. Installing the operating systems. Raspberry Pis use SD cards as storage for the operating system. You can also use USB drives, but I don't recommend them due to the inconvenience of needing a USB hub for a mouse or keyboard, as there will not be enough ports for them both. The community on the Raspberry Pi Wiki has written a guide for beginners on how to set up your SD card with a Raspberry Pi operating system, which is what I will be referencing. There are many different ways to install an operating system onto the Raspberry Pi. I will cover two of them. The first method is installing the operating system onto the SD card from your laptop or desktop PC. Using Windows, the first thing you will need in order to install a Raspberry Pi operating system onto the SD card is an extraction tool called Win32 Disk Imager. Do not try to drag and drop, cut and paste, or otherwise copy the image onto the SD card without using Win32 Disk Imager. It will not work. Copying the Debian operating system image onto an SD card in Windows. First, download the Debian operating system image file from a mirror torrent. The latest version is called 2012-10-28-wheezy-raspbian.img at the raspberry.org download page. Second, extract the image file for the download Demi operating system and save it in a place where you will remember. Third, insert the SD card into your SD card reader and check what drive letter it was assigned. You can easily see the drive letter by looking at the taskbar, Windows Explorer in the computer. If the card is not new and or new and unformatted, you should format it, otherwise Win32 Disk Imager may hang. Fourth, download Win32 Disk Imager utility. You want the binary zip. Fifth, extract the executable from the zip file and run the Win32 disk imager utility. You should run the utility as administrator if the option shows up. Six, when opening Win32 disk imager for the first time, I always get this message. An error occurred while querying your properties. This usually means something is currently accessing this device. Please close all applications and try again. Error 1, incorrect function. It seems to be harmless. Click OK, ignore it, and move on. 7th, select the Debian 2012-10-28-wheezy-resbian.image file you extracted earlier. 8. Select the drive layer of the SD card in the device box. Be careful to select the correct drive. If you get the wrong one, you can destroy your computer's hard disk or other storage. Click write and wait for the write to complete. Do not stop the writing process until complete or it can corrupt your whole SD card. Exit the imager and eject the SD card. Insert the card into the Raspberry Pi. Hook up all the necessary peripherals, such as a monitor, mouse, keyboard. Power it on, and it should boot up. When booting up the device, it will go through a long series of scripts before reaching a BIOS-like menu. It will ask you to do some initial configurations and preference settings. There is an option in the configure script that comes up to expand the partitions to use all of the SD card if you have used one larger than 4 GB. Do that if feasible. After doing that, connect it to the internet and do operating system updates to ensure you have full capability of the operating system and the Raspberry Pi device. Now you have your Raspberry Pi up and running. If you are familiar with Linux, then the operating system should be pretty intuitive from this point on. If you are not familiar with Linux, then your next step is to get familiar with Linux commands and its GUI. The second method is downloading the operating system onto the SD card while hooked to the internet via the Raspberry Pi. You can use the BootBerry Boot Installer to let it download and install the operating system. An additional advantage is that Berry Boot allows you to install more than one operating system on a single SD card. Also, it's not necessary to install any additional software onto your normal Windows, Mac, Linux computer. In addition, it allows you to put an operating system files on an external USB hard drive instead of the SD card itself. Copying the OpenELEC operating system image onto an SD card in Windows, Mac, Linux. First, use a normal Windows, Mac, Linux computer to download a small zip file with the Berry Boot system files and extract it to an empty SD card. Second, put the SD card in your Raspberry Pi. Set it up with the necessary peripherals, again like mentioned before. Third, make sure your internet is up and running and hook it to a router via the Ethernet port. Fourth, follow the on-screen prompts to complete the installation. The first prompt will ask you basic setup questions, such as confirmation that your monitor is working properly, internet connection type, time zone, and region. The second prompt will ask you to select your destination drive. You can install the operating system files on the SD card itself or an external USB stick/disk. Be aware that if you choose an external drive, the files of the operating system will be stored there. But if you need to keep the SD card in the Pi to boot from, you should also see the option of an iSCSI SAN network storage. The Raspberry Pi community enthusiasts set up that network storage for free operating system hosting via the internet, so you can access the operating system from the internet without using storage. Again, you still need to keep the SD card in the Pi to boot from. When formatting all existing data on the drive, it will be erased. The third prompt will ask you what operating system you would like. It gives you the option of Debian, OpenELEC, Puppy Alpha 4, Raspbrazer, Sugar, LSTP, Berry Web Server, and MemTester. Select which operating system you want to install. You can add more later. The fourth prompt is the Berry Boot Menu Editor. You can install more operating systems, rename them, delete them, etc. Press Exit to exit the editor and start using the operating system you installed. Selecting the operating system from this menu will bring up Memory Split Setting. Leave that to default or it may not boot into the operating system successfully upon exiting, and continue to prompt to the Berry Boot Menu Editor. After that, it will reboot and you should see it up and running. That is all for now. I plan on trying out Windows 8 RT in the future, and I hope you enjoyed my tutorial video. For more info, you can go to raspberrypi.org and YouTube user element14, where you can learn far more information about the device, such as the frequently asked questions, origins, and future plans of the device.